explanation, but the man you're about to meet needs none. He is convinced he has seen firsthand the glory of heaven and the horror of hell.
I call myself a hostile witness to heaven and hell.
The first time he died, Matthew DeValle was 12, trying to swim the entire length of a pool underwater. But as he surfaced, his playful friends pushed him back under.
I was completely out of breath. The instant that I took the breath of water in, a white light engulfed me, and I flashed back over my life. I was completely happy to be at this place, and I just wanted more. And out of the middle of the light came an individual, just a beautiful creature. And it was Jesus Christ. And he grabbed me by the wrist and said, "You got to go back." I'm instantly on the side of the pool, on my back.
He had been rescued by his friends, but that glimpse into the afterlife left him confused and profoundly depressed. The next decade became a constant cycle of booze and cocaine-fueled binges, even after he married and had a daughter.
I would drink till I blacked out and found out the cocaine allowed me to drink more and stay awake and not black out.
But the drugs and alcohol never came close to recreating that euphoric boyhood memory of heaven. So he came up with a most unlikely plan to return.
I just said, I can't live like this another day. At that moment, I chose to commit suicide. It was like a joy came over me. It would be the answer to all my problems, and I get to go back to heaven.
He bought his favorite gin and three bottles of sleeping pills, and then drove to a remote bird sanctuary near his home in Anchorage, Alaska.
You swallow the pills one after another.
Right.
Three bottles.
Right.
You're drinking the gin.
Right.
You're in your front seat of your car.
Right. And I get a flash of light, and I'm suddenly outside. And I'm thinking, how the heck did I get out here? And I notice that there's no color. Everything's gray. And I put my head back, and the moment I close my eye, there's another flash. And I'm in mid-free fall into a pit. It's pitch black.
His lifelong wish to return to heaven had ended in a personal vision of hell.
So it was hot.
It was extremely hot, very humid and dense. Smoke coming out of the ground. I am split into seven. Two of me, I'm living in my past, and I'm experiencing all the people that I had met throughout my life. They would come to me and get within my face and start pushing and screaming, and I would relive a moment that I'd caused them pain.
Then he says he saw the suffering his death would eventually cause.
My mother, I was there when she collapsed, finding out I was dead from a suicide. My daughter, she was 18, and she's sitting on the floor contemplating suicide because I wasn't there for her. I was on my hands and face, weeping, not just crying, but weeping for Jesus to save me.
How did you get out?
I was pretty much lifted up by the back of my neck and slowly, very slowly lifted out of this pit. A voice told me, "You have work to do, and if you continue to live the life you are, this is where you're going to spend eternity."
Matthew says he woke up a day later back in his apartment. How he got there remains a mystery. So did Matthew actually visit hell, or was his journey a drug-fueled hallucination, or a trick played by neurons frantically firing in a dying brain?
think it's a very viable hypothesis.
Counselor and educator Jan Holden has interviewed hundreds of people who are convinced they've been to the other side and back.
They say that it's absolutely real and that their consciousness is functioning much like it does in the body, except for some sort of additional abilities.
This theory likens the brain to a cell phone or a radio, receiving these hellish or heavenly images from some other place. Science can't say for sure, but regardless of the cause, the effect is startling. Of all those who die and return, the vast majority are profoundly changed.
This is something so horrific that when I came out of that, I quit a $1,000 a week drug habit, cold turkey.
Matthew sobered up, moved to Las Vegas, and devoted his life to suicide prevention and counseling. People like Lynette Kish, who lost her 16-year-old daughter to suicide.
I actually see horrific things that we do to ourselves. And people say, how can you handle that? But it's nothing to me. It doesn't even come close to what I experienced in hell. When we